Yeah, so hello, my name is Sini Pöytäniemi. He was trying to ask me how do you pronounce it, but better not to even try. And the topic of today, I'm in Finnish National Geoportal. We call it paikkatietoikkuna, that's a place information window, if you want to translate it directly, but paikkatietoikkuna. So it turns 15 years now. I'll start by telling you what is paikkatietoikkuna today, where are we today, and then I'll share a bit of the story of how did we actually get there. So this is how paikkatietoikkuna, the Finnish National Geoportal, looks like. It's supporting spatial data infrastructure implementation in Finland. So what we do here is that you can bring all kind of spatial data that has been published as OGC standards into the geoportal for viewing purposes. And we have thousands of map layers here. So it's kind of trying to combine all data in Finland in one place for people to use. Oops. Okay. So, I mean, just quickly going through what is here. So on the left side, we have the menu, we have the map layers, map legends, possibility to do published maps as embedded on other websites. There are thematic or statistical maps. There's a user guide. There's my data, so you can also create your own features or import data. There's a coordinate transformation tool for Finland. And some other information. There's also possibility to have announcements on the map window. And then you have other tools that are probably very familiar to people in here. So you can pan the map, you can zoom, you can locate yourself. There's an XY tool. You can rotate the map. There's a 3D possibility. You've got different kind of tools like swipe tools. And obviously, you need to find the terms of use. And then there are the background maps. So, I mean, quite a lot of things, but the main thing is you can view nearly all data that exists in Finland in one place. We have around 10,000 registered users. Registered users will have some extra rights to, for example, create their own data or publish embedded maps. But then a guest user can also view all the data that is there already. So we have about 3,000 to 6,000 users daily, and that's maybe nearly 2 million visits a year or something. There are around 70 different organizations, like data producers, that bring data into the geoportal. So together, they have around 3,400 map layers. Part of this is duplicates in the sense that it's also the WMS and WFS or OGC API features, something like this. So you got the raster and vector, and I didn't count this separately here, but let's say 2,000 completely different map layers with different information. And the squares in the background here just represent the size or the number of map layers each of these data producers have brought in. So some of the biggest are the Finnish Environmental Institute and the Traffic Institute. I'm not sure about the names in English here. Yeah, but lots of data. Most of our users, or half of them, are professional users, so that means that they are using this geoportal at work for job, to complete their job. So they are coming there to view data, comparing data, and some of them are also creating their own features, maybe mapping something on the map, publishing it on their own website or somewhere else. And land property data is one of the most popular for the professional users, but then there's also agriculture, forestry, fieldwork, etc. uses for the professional users. But then there is the other half of around, let's say, 60% of people who actually use it also on their free time. So let's say they would be planning their recreational activities, outdoor routes or something like this. So obviously 50 plus 60 makes more than 100, so people are using it on both purposes. Once you learned it, maybe somewhere, so you'll use it in both roles. For professional users, I think the main attraction here is that you don't have to install anything. You got all those 3,000 different map layers there for you. They've been updated, we are maintaining them. And you just come in and start browsing and looking for them. If you're interested in downloading data, as we discussed in the earlier presentation, you will find the way from the metadata at least to go directly to that institute's or organization's website and actually get the like the actual data. So this is more for some people would say it's a demo service, but it's, I mean, people use it really for work. Like we do hear feedback as soon as it would be down unplanned. There are lots of users every day doing their work and can't do their work if it wouldn't be running. But no need to install, no maintenance cost for the people using it at work. I know even in National Land Survey, while we have lots of our own GIS system, people still somehow end up using this one for work as well. It's hard to track because they don't tell us, they just use it for different purposes. And this happens elsewhere as well. For smaller NGOs, especially if you don't have the capacity to install your, like have an own extensive spatial data system, so you just come here and you got most of it and the simple tools. It's not QGIS, it's not trying to be QGIS, but you can do simple spatial things in here as well. So, to the actual story, how did we actually get there? What were the key steps? I'm going to start as far as in the 70s or 80s shortly, but I'll be quick. But it's a story about opening data in Finland in general. I mean, it's part of the, you know, the steps to get where we are today in general when you talk about spatial data infrastructure in Finland. So National Land Survey would be one to first open their topographic data for free, fully for everyone, but that will come later. Before that, 70s, 80s, I mean, we have map production that is still on paper, but it's becoming slowly, partly computer-aided. And then in 89, we got World Wide Web. Things start to happen, you know. Our developers also would be following up what is going on. Websites would start emerging everywhere. It would be possible to have the idea that you could have digital data shared online somewhere. In the 1990s in Finland, computers would become an essential part of work life, so more and more interest in these kind of things. But there would still be a fee for all data that National Land Survey would be serving, and I mean, also nearly all, everybody else around. There were no examples of open and free data. That would be dangerous, that's weird. Just good to remind us sometimes that it was thought dangerous and weird at the time. I mean, like, why would National Land Survey actually share their most valuable asset for free, for everyone, without a fee? I mean, why would you do that? So our developers were, of course, very interested in what was happening. There were particular two guys, and I don't know if one of them is here today, actually. He's been part of this conference. But they would start making their first web map of the websites that the companies in Finland were publishing. So they would put a marker on a map like this company in Helsinki or somewhere published a website. They would become more and more, and suddenly you would have to have a zoomable map. Okay, things start happening, you learn how to do web maps. And finally in 1996, the first map service, Geoportal in Finland would be, not a Geoportal, it's just a web map service, would be opened in Finland. Maybe you can call it Mapsite, Geoportal as well. 9% of Finns would have internet access. Why would you do that? but maybe professional use, and it would become very popular. National Land Survey would actually be trying to sell advertisements, like commercial banners on the website, on the map. Like, I mean, we know what Google is doing today, but like, it wasn't exactly something that a government official would be doing later, but you know, just to cover up the costs, and since we're opening it for free, we need to make some money somewhere. So 1996, we got the map site opened. So viewing National Land Survey map data for free with not so good quality was possible. People got very excited. In 2004, there was a national GIS strategy that would say that there should be a platform that explains spatial data infrastructure for people. And while this list looks like, okay, it's very logical, this is how it happened, there was lots of lobbying and networking of individuals in the background. I mean, it wouldn't happen just like, okay, it's easy and let's do this. You would have to talk. If you had the vision, if you had the idea, if you thought that this is a good idea, you're gonna have to talk behind somewhere to the right people to convince them that, yes, this is a good thing, this is safe, this is for the benefit of the society. Lots of networking of certain people in Finland that had a big vision and they would be ready to do this. 2005, we would review the citizens map site, so version 2. It had already become 10 years old, and the first version, obviously in the 90s, had become quite old technology-wise. You would also be able to download some data, but reduced quality again, and not all of it, and there were some licensing issues. Licensing was very complicated at the time. What are you allowed to do if you download it? Like, commercial use? I mean, like, why? And then 2007, we had Inspire Directive, a very boring sounding EU Commission directive that we all know about, but that would be what would really put speed into these things. I mean, it would really accelerate things to happen and would kind of give what people with the vision about opening data interoperability had in their mind. They would really have a tool in the directive to actually say that this is what we are going to do, this is what we need to do. So 2009, we launched first version of Paikkatietoikkuna. There was a pilot before that where you would, different organizations that already had become excited about this. I guess it was more about certain individuals in these organizations getting excited about this idea and then starting to pilot different kind of APIs to be able to share this data according to the Inspire Directive. And 2011, we would launch the Paikkatietoikkuna code source code as open source code. Come on, I can't speak open source. As under the name of Oskari. And then in 2012, I mean, just to end this story here, National Land Survey would finally open all of their data for free. You do whatever you want with it. It's free. Take it. So. 2009, Paikkatietoikkuna pilot, 7th of July, so on Sunday, we'll have 15th birthday, actually. This pilot would continue in not only creating this geoportal, but also piloting the implementation of different kind of APIs, because that was also a new thing. You would have to support a lot these different organizations so they could actually implement their APIs. Many other organizations at the time joined. There was lots of excitement about it, lots of excited people. When it was published, there were 50 different map layers. So it's a long way until where we are today with 3,400 different map layers, and that's not all we have. Probably at this time, this was all open data that existed in Finland that could be put into the geoportal. So it would become an essential part of supporting the spatial data infrastructure in Finland. And here, I'm just going to actually read this one because I thought it was a bit interesting that it says that in Paikkatietoikkuna you can find an answer to many questions related to GIS. Paikkatietoikkuna introduces spatial data and services as well as organizations and cooperation in the field. Not just a geoportal, it's doing much more. But the goal was, the goal in mind was a lot more. In addition, you can discuss all possible GIS related and launch new communities or join them. As a pilot of spatial data portal, Paikkatietoikkuna offers an experimental communal platform for all interested in the new opportunities in GIS. At that time, something very special. People would come here and read the news updates about what was happening in GIS in Finland at that time. So it was more of an information portal rather than just a map portal. Here you can see the map window of it, but on the top you can actually see it's only in Finnish at the time. Today we have it in also in English. But there would be on the left, that's front page. Then it says geodata search. Then there's the map window where we are now. There would be already the publishing of maps made possible, so you could embed maps on other websites. There's stories about Inspire. What is the what does the directive say and require you to do? News and explaining what is this thing. But already 2009, quite a nice map window with lots of functionalities. At that time, Oskari or Paikkatietoikkuna would be built with these parts, so they would be for the information or the like the website part, it would be the live ray, and then for the map window, we would use open layers. On the background, you would have GeoServer and PostGIS. Today, Liferay and GeoServer are off the picture. My colleague Sami will be explaining more about what Oskari is technology-wise later today. Then 2011, as I said, so there would be the launch of Oskari. So not only did we want to have this one geoportal, but we wanted to share the code so that people would actually be able to benefit from it, not only by, you know, we have this one geoportal, but we also want to make the code available. And this was new at the time, and it was, I mean, it was National Land Survey. It was a government office that would decide that we are opening this as an open code. We would get the oskari.org domain and put Oskari code on GitHub for everybody, and there would be a community kickstart. And lots of these people who were part of the Paikkatietoikkuna community would become part of Oskari community as well and start installing their own Oskari instances. Key goals, we wanted more beneficiaries. We want to support the spatial data infrastructure beyond just this one geoportal. Using OGC, international standards, and we wanted it from the start to have the easy embedded maps included. So this is one of the older GitHub pages, but I'm not exactly sure from which time it is. But it's not from 6 days ago, as it says here. It's it was a bit older at the time, but I couldn't find a date on it. 2012 maybe. So today, I mean, Paikkatietoikkuna, or the story I wanted to tell, is not only about this one geoportal, but it's also a story of Oskari and how that became something more. So there's lots of Oskari-based services today in Finland. So more people benefiting, not only from that one geoportal, but also from the code itself, able to put up their own geoportals as they wish. Paikkatietoikkuna, Oskari go in hand still today. So in National Land Survey, especially where we develop also Oskari or contribute to Oskari, Paikkatietoikkuna is where we test everything we do, basically. So that's our end users are quite active, so we get a lot of feedback of like what should be doing or if there are bugs or whatever. It's a bit of a playground for new things as well. We can try new projects or new spatial things that you could do on a geoportal and try it there. And that's always been the spirit. I mean, somebody did say that Paikkatietoikkuna or Oskari was what started agile development in National Land Survey, and I think that's quite true. There were five principles that were guiding development of Paikkatietoikkuna then and now. So Paikkatietoikkuna would combine map layers in one place. It is open to anyone. It is free. We wanted to save money, not from only our money, but like in general. And we wanted to be made together. And final slide. In conclusion, so I would say Paikkatietoikkuna is in the core of Finnish spatial data infrastructure. It has thousands of committed users every day. Paikkatietoikkuna is made possible by a long-term cooperation by people in Finland, in the public sector especially. Beyond public sector, obviously we need also commercial partners to be developing things, and we still have quite enthusiastic developers in different places. And Oskari enables others to benefit from its development. So we are developing maybe Paikkatietoikkuna or Finnish National Land Surveys map services, but other people can benefit from it by using Oskari as well. Using an open source software is now actually, since a couple of years, in the National Land Survey guidelines as well. So maybe we did something in the end. Thanks.
Thanks, Sini, for presenting us Paikatito Ikuna. I tried to pronunciate it. And all the history that came with it. I think that always gives good insights for how to implement these things and the road to open source, which probably is a difficult one.
And a disclaimer, I wasn't there when it started.
Yeah. You skipped the best part, I guess. Any questions from the audience? No, then I will have a question. Yes, still a bit going back to that history where you were not part of, but did you hear from colleagues what made it a success, this transition to a real spatial data infrastructure using open source software, if you would advise others who are in that trajectory?
Lots of background work. I would still repeat that, like, you need to network, you need to lobby, you need to discuss, you need to convince the right people that it is safe. It's not weird, but it's actually, you know, have the vision in mind. I think there were a few visionaries that were, you know, since 80s thinking that this is where they want to be.
That's good. And then you will have critical mass at some point and there'll be uptake. Any questions? I have a question for Ian. Was this a good geoportal? Sorry, I had to ask this.
Go for it.
It's good.
No worries.
Thanks, Sini. I was wondering, could you tell us a bit about future things happening, or is this coming at another session, or what's going on? What's going to happen with Paikkatieto Ikkuna in the near future?
I did have in the morning another presentation about OSCAR itself, but with Paikkatieto Ikkuna, I think, like, one of the things we do today a lot is maintaining thousands of map layers, and this is still a lot manual work because all of the different data producers produce different kind of data, and so working with that. But I think lots of it has been done. I don't think there are any radical changes coming up, like, in the coming couple of years. But I think what we need to do and improve is working together with the data producers and the end users, but especially with the data producers, to actually be able to do a good service which functions, like, well. So we're also working with the different kind of admin tools where you can, let's say, monitor the thousands of map layers, like what is working and what is not, and how to fix them and make it easier to maintain it. I don't think too many geoportals, like, not all geoportals have that much data, so it's a bit of a struggle to kind of be able to scale it. It's not many years ago that it was just 1,500, and now it's double. So, figuring out ways how to make it easy.
Other questions? Yes.
I like what you did with the geoportal. I cannot pronounce the name, sorry. I see this is different than what the Dutch do, like the national Geo Register. How do you work together with people in Europe or abroad to? You're now talking during this presentation, what you did. Is OSCARI being used outside of Finland, or is it just there? And how can you work together? Is OSCARI being used outside of Finland? Or only...
OSCARI, yeah.
OSCARI, sorry. And how do you work together with in European partners?
I think there are two things here. I mean, we can talk about the OSCARI as an open source project, and then we can talk about Paikkatieto Ikkuna and Inspire and spatial data infrastructure. So, I mean, first of all, Paikkatieto Ikkuna is part of Inspire implementation as well, and in general, the spatial data infrastructure implementation. So there is a team in National Land Survey who is working with internationally with people who also have these same Inspire worries, let's say, and same needs. But then OSCARI is different because that's an open source project, so we have the community mostly in Finland, almost nearly only in Finland, who are using OSCARI to implement their own geoportals.
I'm also thinking about the UI design and how I think the user stories or what the user wants are the same all over Europe. So I'm more thinking about how you... What you learned the last 20 years, how you can bring it further, or
I think that is a good question, and yes, there should be more cooperation. I think the user interface planning is something we need to concentrate on, for sure. It can be improved all the time. There has been in the community some planning regarding that, but then some of the implementation is missing, and I think it's also something you need to reiterate all the time. I'm not sure how the European cooperation regarding the user interface would work, but I mean, that's why we are here today also. I mean, seeing what others are doing and discussing with people and seeing what works.
That's indeed the case that we are here. So that's a good point to end the discussion. And thanks again.
Thank you.